The war in Ukraine has changed the world. In Europe, it's torn a continent apart and pulled the Western alliance back together. It looks like a new kind of Cold War has begun.
Here in Asia, all of that might seem far away, but in today's world, everything is connected. There's already a battle for domination underway for this giant continent, a battle that's now intensifying in unpredictable ways. And you might not expect it, but at the heart of it, right here, is India.
India finds itself in a dramatic geopolitical squeeze. Russia, its old friend and arms supplier, is deepening ties with China, weakened by the war and becoming subservient to a power that's no friend to India.
There are serious concerns in New Delhi about whether Russia will continue to be a reliable supplier.
At the same time, China's threat to India becomes ever more apparent, compelling India to reinforce its borders against attempts to take its territory.
So the Chinese are breathing down our borders, and they've just killed our soldiers less than 2 years ago.
And Delhi faces deep dilemmas over how close to get to the West.
The US has had many, many alliances. Not all of them have fared very well.
India has a long tradition of avoiding close alliances and preferring to stay non-aligned. But the war is forcing it to think again about all of its relationships and face up to some choices it hasn't had to make before.
In part one of this video, we'll look at how durable India's old friendship with Russia really is and whether it can survive Moscow's new path.
The Russia relationship is now in a position where it really does need to be rethought.
In part two, we'll see how tensions between India and China are far more dangerous than the rest of the world realizes. Think about this. Beijing even says that it should control an entire Indian state. After Russia's invasion of Ukraine, it's all too easy to imagine a devastating war.
So we are talking about a very big section of the world, a very important part of the world, a very large armies, nuclear armed countries fighting each other.
And in part three, we'll ask whether India and the West can really come together, or if they're ultimately heading in very different directions.
When China attacked us, where was this degree of outrage from Europe or from other countries? Yes, there was a little bit of finger wagging and tongue clicking, but nothing in comparison to what we are seeing.
Europe has a legacy problem with India because of the experience of colonialism. I think countries have to be very mindful of what leverage they have to influence change.
India is coming to resemble Russia and China far more than it resembles Western democracies.
So as the world enters this dangerous new era, India could be the deciding factor. So no matter where you are in the world, the choices made here in Delhi matter to you. So let's get into this story with a decision that India has been trying not to make, but maybe forced to, about an old friend gone rogue.
The UN Security Council, February 2022. The high table of world affairs gathers to pass judgment on Russia's invasion of Ukraine. India's ambassador is here, holding his country's non-permanent seat. He calls for a ceasefire.
We urge that all efforts are made for the immediate cessation of violence and hostilities.
The Western powers vote to condemn the war. Russia casts its veto, and India abstains.
What was India doing here? It was joining the likes of China in refusing to condemn Russia's invasion. Well, this wasn't a matter of principle. This was all about pragmatism and not wanting to anger a valued friend.
Delhi, just 2 months earlier, Vladimir Putin on a rare trip abroad, heaping praise on his host.
Is замечательный предыстории нашей отношений.
The relationship has roots in the depths of the Cold War. In 1971, Indira Gandhi and Leonid Brezhnev were both concerned about tensions with China. The result, the Indo-Soviet Treaty of Peace, Friendship and Cooperation. India's policy of non-alignment meant the treaty stopped short of being a full alliance, but it helped to seal Moscow's position as India's number one arms supplier, something that's not been forgotten. Jay Panda is vice president of India's governing BJP party.
Russia, or the former Soviet Union, had stood by India when we needed defense capabilities to deal with these challenges of China and others. It was the Soviet Union and continuing into Russia that gave us equipment.
Fast forward to the end of 2021 and Putin's visit to Delhi, and arms were very much on the agenda. Russia is supplying high-tech gear like its S-400 air defense missiles to India. That deal is so sensitive that the United States has threatened India with sanctions for it. But Delhi is sticking to the deal and counters that the West won't match Russia on providing the military tech that it needs.
We are still denied certain key defense technologies which are critical for our safety and for our security. And we have been getting them from Russia.
Moscow has also done deals allowing Indian manufacturers to make hardware like these Russian tanks. That's something other suppliers have been reluctant to do. India not only gets the tanks, it also boosts its own defense industry, a major strategic priority. But pressure is mounting from the West for India to make a break with Russia over the war on Ukraine. When Prime Minister Narendra Modi welcomed the European Union's top official to Delhi in April 2022, Ursula von der Leyen brought her personal experience from a trip to the war zone and warned her hosts not to look away.
I visited Bucha. I saw with my own eyes the bodies lined up on the ground. The outcome of the war will not only determine the future of Europe, for the Indo-Pacific region, it is as important as for Europe that borders are respected.
But at the same event, India's flagship security conference, the Raisina Dialogue, India's Minister of External Affairs said Asians would not be lectured to.
We've been hearing for the last 2 months a lot of arguments from Europe, saying, you know, there are things happening in Europe and Asia should worry about it because these could happen in Asia. Guess what? Things have been happening in Asia for the last 10 years. Now, Europe may not have looked at it. This could be a wake-up call for Europe, not just in Europe. It could be a wake-up call for Europe to also look at Asia.
It was a clear rebuke from India's top diplomat to the most powerful figure in the European Union. And the message was unmistakable. Don't tell us what to do.
For many delegates, Western outrage over Russia's behavior and calls for India to cut imports of Russian energy simply rang hollow. Shamika Ravi is an economist with India's ORF think tank.
We have just come out of poverty. We still have an absolute poverty of 5 to 6%. So for us to bear some of the costs that Europe expects us to bear, while at a time when very affluent European countries continue to depend on Russian oil is it just smacks of blatant hypocrisy.
The US and other Western countries, especially the US, have done exactly this same kind of operation in many countries. They have a track record of invading countries, sometimes with UN concurrence, but many times without UN concurrence. So we have to have norms that apply to all.
But despite all this, there are misgivings here in India about what Russia's up to. Not so much about principles, but about hard realities.
Garima Mohan is an expert on India's relations with Europe.
The India-Russia partnership is very one-note. It is mostly about military equipment and defense supplies. The way the war is unfolding in Ukraine right now, there are serious concerns in New Delhi about whether Russia will continue to be a reliable supplier in the long run.
A weakened Russia with a degraded military industrial infrastructure is not going to be the major, reliable, efficient partner that we were counting upon. before the war.
Shashi Tharoor is a leading figure in the opposition Congress Party and a former Under Secretary General of the United Nations.
I think that the Russia relationship is now in a position where it really does need to be rethought. There's a historical factor, if you like, of a long series of IOUs to first the Soviet Union and then to some degree to the Russian Federation, particularly when it came to sensitive Indian issues like Kashmir and so on, where they supported India, often vetoing unfriendly positions taken by other members of the Security Council, including some of the Western powers. That has all changed. The Western countries have now, by and large, supported the Indian stand on Kashmir, and I don't think we will now need a Russian veto anymore to be able to keep some issues off the agenda that we don't like being discussed there. Second, there is a long sense of dependence on Russia, and again the Soviet Union before that, for military supplies and equipment. But that was already on the way down. If you look at a five-year period in the first half of the last decade, I think we may have bought as much as 75% of our military supplies from Russia. If you look at the second five-year period, it came down to about 45%. India has been diversifying its military supplies, going to America, to Israel, to France and other countries for major equipment.
The Americans are watching, waiting to see how India responds to the decline in Russian fortunes. Lisa Curtis served as senior director for South Asia in the U.S. National Security Council.
It's clear that Russia will simply not have the capability to be a reliable partner to India moving forward. I think India will naturally diversify its military imports away from Russia because it will have to. Russia will not be able to export the kind of items that India needs. But my hope is that India recognizes this and starts to take the steps that it needs to take to diversify away from Russia.
Only a few Russian delegates made it to Delhi to join the discussions at the Raisina Dialogue. But we caught up with one who did. Alexey Kupriyanov is an expert on India at a state-backed think tank in Moscow. He insists that Russia's ties with India still have huge potential.
Our past relations were fantastic. Our future relations for us, we think, will be fantastic as well, because and Russia and India see the world the same way. We are now cut off the Western markets, Western investments and Western technologies. So we do not have other choice as to turn to the East. India is will be our main market for our technologies, for our products, for our fertilizers, for our grain.
But above all, turning east for Russia means turning to China. And sure enough, Vladimir Putin and Xi Jinping met in Beijing on the eve of the war. They sealed a partnership that they said would have no limits. This does carry risks for Russia, though, of becoming subservient to a much more powerful Beijing. Moscow is aware of this, says Alexey Kupriyanov. One reason it wants to keep India in play.
I think our relations with China will be relations of good friends who are supporting each other in this very hard situation after the Ukrainian conflict, because China now is under pressure of the United States and we are under pressure as well. In fact, the United States just push us to China, maybe in some fields against our will. And we are trying to keep a distance between us and China because, I can repeat, we do not want to be Chinese junior partner.
And yet, while they might not want to be, the Russians clearly will be the junior partner in relations with China. Some are even saying Russia is destined to become a client state.
Surely, the way things are going, whatever happens as this war unfolds, Russia is going to emerge weakened. Weakened by sanctions, weakened by the calamities of war, weakened by the damage to its industry and its manufacturing by the conflict. Will it end up becoming a vassal state of China, a China that is hostile to India? I think it looks very, very likely that a weakened Russia will have no choice, particularly if the war ends but the ostracism continues and the Western countries continue to treat Russia as a pariah. They will have no choice but to look for a patron, a supplier, a market, etc. in China, and they will turn there. And if they turn there, the price will have to be that they will have to pay more heed to China's strategic interests.
This really matters to India, because a Russia that comes under China's thumb isn't just less useful as a friend, it strengthens the hand of India's greatest potential enemy.
Coming up in part two. High in the Himalayas, near the frontier with China, India's leader has come to rally the troops. An outbreak of violence with Chinese forces in this remote, disputed border zone of Ladakh has shaken the whole of India and left 20 troops dead.
So in our consciousness, China is a threat. They keep disrespecting the boundary agreements that we have with them.
Are we going to continue to just sit around temporizing, or are we going to examine broader options?
As India boosts its forces in Arunachal Pradesh, it's facing a real possibility of war with its superpower neighbor.
It's a much bigger power. Chinese economy is 6 times India's size. You know, Chinese defense spending is 4 times India's size. China definitely has more diplomatic power, more global power.
If things come to blows with the Chinese on the border, there's very little that Russia will be able and willing to do for India.